And what LeSS is, LeSS is large scale Scrum framework. What is SAFe, it's a scaled agile framework. This talk is comparing two things that are pretty much uncomparable. So we basically decided to look them from a couple of angles that we go here. And one of them is work coordination, then there is a batching and queuing, and then how to control work in organization, and looking even from business point of view. So let's see how it goes. I'm Ran Nyman. I worked with the LeSS framework since 2005. It was not called LeSS at that point, but it was still existing framework, and when we now look at LeSS literature, it basically was 2005 what we did there. And from 2008 till 2011, I worked with the SAFe framework with a couple of big organizations, so I know how they work. You can leave them there. There's a question about the stuff there. So, I'm a certified Scrum trainer that you could see there on the slides if the slides would show that it is there. But at least it shows that I'm a certified LeSS trainer. So, why do you want to scale up? Agility. So basically, the problem is that your organization is this kind of state. You have a huge amount of people there, huge amount of things moving there or stuck there. So you want to get rid of this situation. So you want to scale up agility. Of course, the first advice is that don't do it. The more people you add in your organization, the slower it will go. There are already literatures from 1950s showing that it doesn't work adding more people. They saw a quote from Sage Project that is one of the biggest, the first big software development project having over 1,000 people. When the R&D manager was asked that what would you do differently when they have finished over budget, over time, the project, he said that I would take 100 best people that I had in my organization and do the project with them instead of having the 1,000 people there. So how do organizations then end up big and wasteful? The answer is easily using common sense and fashionable solutions. And let's look how it goes. First, in the beginning, you have some business. And then you have some developers developing something, and somebody wants to give some money to the company developing the products. And then you have some manager who basically pulls the people together, and you are able to build products. The business is growing. You add more and more developers. You end up having more and more customers. And it's not going so smoothly anymore. So what would you do then? You have verified the thing that having specialists in developing, testing, architecture, and documentation work. So the common solution is that let's hire coordination specialists, also known as project managers, to coordinate the work. So the project management put the developers in nice boxes, and basically the work start flowing. Now the business is growing even more. You keep on adding more and more people and even more project managers. Now the management has totally lost the big picture, but luckily they have still the project managers who are able to get something out of the system. Then it grows and grows, and at some point you end up in a situation that not even the project managers help there. The management is totally clueless. Everything is moving really, really slowly. And people are becoming resources instead of people. Management has detached themselves from totally from reality. They have no clue what happens there on the bottom level. And here we have then adjectives or statements, what it seems to work in this kind of organization. You have waiting, wasting, loss of knowledge, bad atmosphere, reorganization, unclarity. And it seems always when you try to do something in organization, you cannot decide anything. The wisdom and power is always somewhere else. Have you been in this kind of organization? Of course, here the solution would be that let's try to do it harder. And you don't change thinking what is there behind. You keep on adding project managers, you keep on specializing people. It doesn't move anywhere. Or then looking at Agile, fundamental change of thinking. Putting people instead of this kind of driven by project managers in this kind of a teams that are customer-centric, focused on delivering products to customers, having business people directly work with the customers. But this would need basically fundamental change in thinking. This would mean that the organization would become agile. Less of the, this kind of a talk describes how SAFE and LeSS tries to move from this kind of a project-based organization towards agile organization and what kind of solution they provide. So what to do? Scrum seems to work on one team. And then there was the SAFE framework where you have Scrum there somewhere in the corner. It's there somewhere. And then you have lots of other people there on top of that. But it seems that if you know that Scrum works on one team, it looks like SAFE would be one of your solutions. And then there's the LeSS framework, basically where Scrum is in the center. And one of their slogans is that large-scale Scrum is Scrum. So the differentiator factor is that do you put Scrum in one corner of your graph or you put Scrum in your center and then you add things there that enable Scrum, like principles. How should we organize our organization? What thinking there is behind? Then how to create, how to adopt LeSS in organization? What kind of management support there is needed? And then kind of what kind of structure we need there? And without forgetting that some technical excellence is also needed. And this is bigger picture of LeSS, but let's not look at that more. So the key thing here is how you organize your things. Do you organize on technology specialization or customer specialization? And let's first look this kind of a component technology task specialization and how does it look like from the people working there and how the work is going through the organization. So we have some teams here. They focused on technology. They deliver something front-end, middleware, back-end, or whatever. This is typical way of organizing teams. Then you have the customers somewhere, and the customers, of course, want the release from somewhere. There is a problem with the customer. Typically, the problem is delivered to the product managers. And what should the product manager do with the problem? They have collected information from customers that we need to build some features. But we have this kind of technology specialized teams. Which team would do the feature? Of course, we need somebody there. Typically, the somebody is we need some enterprise architect or something like that, who is splitting the work towards the teams. Now the teams could start working on the things, but there is a huge amount of dependencies between the teams because the features or the customer problems, they are not technology specialized. They are specialized on end-to-end. So we need there somebody to coordinate it. And who is the coordination typically? It's the project managers. So we added their enterprise architects and project management as minimum when you have technology specialized teams. The more teams you have there, the more people you have typically there. Now, about the deployment. Which team is going to deploy it? All of the teams are building their own technological part. So none of the teams can deploy it by themselves. So typically what we need there, we need some kind of a system integration, testing, or even continuous deployment team. But that is separate team from the teams who develop the work. Typical roles that you see in organization who pre-process the requirements from customers are listed there. There's a huge amount of things, and I'm not going to read them through. So these people there, they discuss about things. They generate huge amount of ideas what to do. So where they put their ideas is, of course, the tool in agile development that's called the bloated product backlog or bloated backlog. You have lots of ideas from enterprise architects, system specialists, system analysts, business analysts, and they store all their ideas in the backlog. You can basically look any organization, how they work, that looking at their backlog. If they have huge amount of nice ideas in their backlog, you can bet that there's huge amount of people generating them also. This is not the only problem with the thing that your backlog gets about bloated, but when there is a problem in one team, they are busy on doing the work, so what to do then? You probably need on adding there more people. That's the common solution. Of course, they are not busy, but other parts of organization are busy. You basically keep on adding people there inside the organization and adding more and more people in each of the unit. And why does it happen so is that you hire people for the specialized skills like in database or in the front end. They can never transfer from one part of the organization somewhere else. So the organization just keep on growing and growing because you tend to be always in a busy state. And of course, one part that is always busy is the system integration and testing, and the organization just keep on growing and growing. So how does it feel to work in this kind of organization? You are working in one of the development teams there. Luckily, you have technology that you can work with, but actually you don't. Enterprise architects, the specification people, they give you the work. They select the tools for you. So basically, you just work there by limited, that how organization limits your freedom. And the other thing is that, do you see ever the customers or their problems? No, you get just requirements for you and you implement some requirements. Do you see any end results? Maybe, maybe not. But at least you don't see how your requirements contributed to that end result. So it's not even really fun place at work. So what would be then alternative on this? Instead of organizing in this kind of a technology or task specialization, is it is of course customer-centric feature teams. And how does it work? We have a customer, we have a team. Customer has some problem. And the problem, of course, somewhere in the organization, you have a product manager, product owner, whoever does the work with the problem. He prioritizes the work using some kind of a backlog based on what he thinks is most important, gives the work to the team, and the team is discussing with the product owner to get the work done. And then at the end, you get some release deployment. This is basically what Scrum says. You have teams who take full responsibility of creating product increment. Now, when you scale, instead of scale in this kind of a technology or task domain, when you scale the Scrum team, Scrum feature teams there, how does it go then? You just keep on adding these kind of teams that take end-to-end responsibility of delivering the product. And they deploy the product directly and clarify the requirements directly with the customers. If you are more interested, there's a website called featureteams.org. It tells much more about feature teams. But basic idea is that everybody knows Scrum. with one team Scrum, one team is doing the work. So basically you just take these development teams and call them feature teams and multiply them. How to control then in working organization? We are a big organization, we have huge amount of teams there in organization, so how to control to get something out of the organization? There is still person, he's still alive, William Auchi. He came with this kind of idea that there's a three basic control mechanism organization that I go through. He invented those, and then he is also famous about inventing this kind of a theory Z on top of theory Y and X that were developed by McGregor. So what kind of control mechanisms he found out in organizations? He basically identified three things: market control, and then we have a bureaucratic control and clan control. And he identified this by looking at how work is enabled in organization, how to get work done, how people control each other, how you control the organization, that it output is something. In a market control, it's simple. You have some business agreement. It's very exact. I give you money, you give me product. It's very simple. That is, you specify an agreement, everything. If the product is not coming when I want it, you pay me a fine. Then there is a clan control. But he find out that all of the organization, this is happening. There are people in working with having informal rules how to get work done. What William Auchi find out that this is only thing that works this kind of clan control, then work is interdependent, ambitious, or we cannot define it. Because then we have to discuss how to get work done. There's no other way of controlling how the people get the work done. Then there is a bureaucratic control that pretty much everybody know. And it's based on hierarchy and formal power in organization. One example of bureaucratic contract is this kind of employment contract. You go to work for one company, and you sign the contract, and the contract says that we give you money and you work for us. But it's not full contract. You basically just decided because of the money, the management is able to give you work, and you assume that the management is evaluating you fairly. Now it comes interesting when we look at the clan control. The work is something that you cannot define. You don't know how the work is happening. How can the management evaluate you fairly if the management is using bureaucratic control? Probably not very well. And lots of the conflict inside the organization becomes that management thinks that they can control the teams using bureaucratic control and hierarchical power. So let's look at then three layers in organization and where these control mechanisms are most prevailing. These are in all of the part of the organization, but where it's mostly used. This kind of a top business management works with economical reality. They use market control. Then we have front-end control. Front-end workers who use clan control because they have to get things done, agree how to solve tough technical problems that you cannot specify how to solve them. Then we have a middle management using bureaucratic control because they are there in the between. They are detached from the reality. So basically all their work is pretty much following the processes, make sure that we follow level of authority and things like that. So what do they do then, the middle management? They analyze, coordinate, intermediate, execute, and this is basically what they do there. So where is the actual power? The power is in the top. We have a top management, typically some business unit leader, and he has the power to decide how many people we hire, what products we have in the organization, do we buy some other companies, or things like that. Then we have this kind of a low level, we have the front-end workers, they work with the technical reality because they have to actually achieve something and they can decide what to do there. And in the middle, we have this kind of a dependent power. Middle management, they depend on each other and then they also depend on the top and the low level. This leads to politics. And you wonder why your managers are always in the meetings is because to get work done in the middle, you have to discuss with other people. And in politics, there's nothing bad with that. It's just ways of discussing getting something done. It's just only way of doing that there. So let's then contrast how this kind of a scaled agile framework looks in these kind of a control mechanisms. And basically, it has some clan systems, social rules there. As I said, in the bottom, we have the Scrum teams. Middle, we have lots of written rules, processes, roles, descriptions, and hierarchical power decided that who will decide what. And then we have there top, we have the market system, basically the enterprise deciding where to invest money. Even most of the portfolio layer in the safe is just coordinating portfolio. It's not actually making key decision where to invest money. Now, if we contrast that directly with the Scrum. Scrum, this kind of market control is nicely achieved, but you have a, in the beginning, product owner basically discussing maybe with the business side or actually making the key decisions at least. Then the team is left alone to do the work. They can coordinate their work whatever they like. There is no bureaucrats there to say that you have to do the work like this. And at the end, the team is evaluated. What did you achieve? The product owner gives feedback, and also the product owner is evaluated at the end. So how does then look for the LeSS framework? In the beginning, we have product owner deciding what to do with the teams. In the middle, teams are left alone. And then at the end, there is basically something coming out, and the product owner is evaluating the teams. So how then to coordinate work inside the organization? Manage dependency coordinating people's time. It's basically the coordination chaos that I described there. And this is basically traditional way of doing it. And basically you have the projects there coordinating people's work. And how does they reflect to the this kind of levels of control? They basically, you have big level of bureaucratic control there in between. Then there is this kind of another way of doing that. That's pretty much when you have teams that are technology focused, and basically you have then programs coordinating the type teams. It doesn't change much. A little bit less bureaucracy because teams takes more responsibility, but still the coordination between the teams is done by the program and separate roles there. Now, when you move to feature teams, what happens there then? Basically, each team is responsible of coordinating their work inside the team so they are able to create the product increments. And then we have some business person hopefully make some decision what they do. And the team's job is to work as broadly in the technology as possible and make it happen. Teams coordinate if there are some dependencies between the teams, and this is basically the key thing when you have a feature teams. There should be very little coordination between the teams. If there is some, teams take responsibility for doing that. So what happens to the control layers? The market control moves closer because we have actually the business person making key decision. The client control moves upwards, and then the bureaucratic system hopefully goes smaller when the teams take more and more responsibility. So how to move the focus away from projects to customers then? What is the key thing there? And the key, most of the organization, how they have organized this kind of a silos. We have some functional department. Typical departments are testing, development, specification, and then project go there across these. So this is not way of organizing in way that you can work with the customers, because each of the department can only talk about testing, and is the customer really interested in testing? Not much. So basically the idea would be to create product organization where you have teams able to discuss directly with customers, because they take the whole requirement in and create something end-to-end towards customers. And of course, this is then the challenging part when you move from this kind of a functional organization to product organization. Because what happens to the managers there at top is not specified. At least less managers are needed, or they become team managers. But this requires some management decision. How do you adopt LeSS? Basically, the key thing is here. You create structure so that the teams are able to work directly with the customers. This is the key thing in adoption. Of course, then when the teams start working directly with the customer and try to create something end-to-end, probably their technological skills needs to increase. And you have to create some kind of a technical enabler so the teams can actually deliver something end-to-end there. Now you discuss with this kind of a manager there in organization, what do they say? It's not possible, changing everything. And basically changing everything is really, really risky. But if you don't change, nothing will happen. Change without change is impossible. So what you want to do is that you want to focus on some part of the organization and change that one to be agile, having feature teams, moving toward large-scale Scrum framework. But that's part that probably would be how many people we have in this room now. It wouldn't be the whole organization. You define some part where you start, and then you learn how does it work in your organization, and what works there and what not. You're not moving the whole organization to use large-scale Scrum framework, unless it's really small. So why would you want to do that? What are the economical reasons there? And the reasons are basically we have component teams and programs, or we have a feature teams. With this kind of a component teams, there's always coordination cost. It's necessary waste there. You are never getting rid of that. Somebody has to coordinate work with the component team. When you have feature teams, they coordinate their work and limit dependencies. Where you focus is in learning. You basically broaden the knowledge of the teams. They learn more of their technology, learn of the customer problem, how to solve them. And this is something that is investment. It should start paying off at some point. Flow of the work in organization then. Who is missing when we have this kind of a business management, front-end workers, and bureaucrats there in the between? Of course, the customer or user. Typical organization, when they have huge bureaucratic layer, how they do the coordination? Basically, it happens like this. The middle management, they have lots of coordination roles, and they also take work of coordinating the customer problems toward the front end and towards the top. And how safe is solving this problem is that let's keep all those middle management roles there, or at least pretty much of them, and all the work is going from the customer throughout all the layers in organization until at some point they reach the teams. Now, when you move from technology specialization to customer specialization, what is the key thing there that you have to keep in mind is that when you move the team specialized on understanding customer problems, they are able to work more directly with the customers because they understand their problems. They start speaking the customer language instead of what SQL lines we need to have in the database. So how that is advised to do in the large-scale Scrum framework is then in the beginning, product owner represent customer, discusses with customers how to prioritize things. Then during the sprint, basically, team should have a requirements analysis sessions with the customers so they know in the next sprint what to do. And then at the end of the sprint, teams get direct feedback from the customers how their work was achieved. So basically, moving the teams closer to the customers. But then the problem is that the large organization, huge amount of teams, only few amount of customers. It's simple, but it's not easy. You need to structure the things in the correct way so you make it happen. And then how to run this kind of a big meetings with lots of teams so customers get something out of that, and how the teams get some feedback out of that. There are solutions. They are not even coming from LeSS. They are coming from lots of other things. But how to run this kind of a big session with lots of people effectively. Huge amount of facilitation techniques that are available. Though, why would you do it? Why would you create organization that talks directly with the customers and forces the teams to learn? Because if the team is not learning, they are not able to talk with customer and they are not able to deliver any meaningful software for customers. They don't learn to do more things together. The key problem here is that learning causes anxiety. And according to Edgar Schein, it's only survival anxiety is bigger than learning anxiety. So key thing is that you create organization that the teams in the organization to survive here, you have to learn. So, and you can be amazed when they have to learn, they start learning. If you give them chance that they just do the requirements, they keep on doing the requirements without much learning. This is really leadership challenge in organization, how to form the organization and how to basically get it happen. It's not an easy task. Like any real change, it's not easy to create real change in organization. Then batch size and queues. Here's a fundamental formula that we have coined that the longer you need plan longer if you have really specialized teams. Basically, the reach of the planning has to be longer. Why is it so? If you aim for high capacity utilization, you need to plan longer if you have really specialized teams. Because none of the customer requirements are evenly split with your team, so if you want to have all the teams busy on something, it's good to plan longer because all of the teams get some work. We have not really formalized yet the mathematical proof behind that, but we are working on it. It requires some analysis. So, safe batch size. How much work in the safe you typically plan? You have this kind of a release planning meeting that you do every second or every third month, depending on organization, and basically you move work from there outside the system, inside the development system. And then the program is over, and basically then you start another program plan. Nothing though prevents that you could release several times during this kind of increment there in the safe, but what this picture says is that you plan for the whole 2 to 3 months, and you move huge amount of work inside the system. Then, contrasting to large-scale Scrum batch sizes, basically you have some work to be done, and then you have less system there. You have a sprint planning meeting. You move work something to 2 to 4 weeks inside the system, and after that you have some increment ready. Nothing though prevents even in the less that you could release every day. So, what's the problem with big batches? They typically lead to high holding costs, lots of work in progress, lots of queues in organization, and things like that. But there are some laws there in the why it's done so in the ways where you are not able to do. And let's look first picture of safe. So, if this kind of a planning cost is high, or releasing cost is high, basically your optimal batch size would be somewhere there, and basically to minimize the cost. Only way to move this kind of a smaller batch size in less, so the safe meaning would be that your planning and releasing cost gets down. To my knowledge, SAFe is not advocating anything like this, but maybe it is. I'm not so special about that. So then how about LeSS there? The key thing in LeSS was that we planned for 2 weeks. And after 2 weeks, we aim to release something. So that basically tries to move our batch size smaller by forcing us to reduce planning and releasing costs. Otherwise, after 2 weeks, you have nothing done. If you have 3 months' time to do it, it doesn't force you to reduce the cost there. It just tries to drive organization to be faster, just by having shorter iteration. Then queues there that we discussed a little bit, but I have a picture here that shows what it happens. You plan the sprints and you plan the work on some level in the release planning meeting so you can, after release planning meeting, commit. It basically focuses on optimal resource utilization. Of course, in the LeSS we have queues also, but the queues are only for 2 weeks. And basically those are over. And what it optimizes is that the outcomes after each release. Everybody probably have seen the problem between this kind of a queues inside the system and big batches, and what is the problem there, so I'm not going to go through it. But this is the nice quote from Stefan Tomke and Donald Reinertsen, is that queues delay feedback, causing developers to follow unproductive paths longer. They make it hard for companies to adjust to evolving market needs and to detect weaknesses in their product development before it's too late. So queues and big batch sizes, they're actually quite big problem. So we have 15 minutes time. So we don't skip the slide. All right, business view. This was in the coordination chaos, the situation in the beginning, but we discussed you have some customer, some business, some team doing it. And then you keep on adding their basically teams or members there. And basically while you add more people there, you tend to add also more managers. And if you look from Agile Manifesto, what does it say? It says that business and developers should work together and things like that. And when you have lots of managers, they're intermediating things, it doesn't really follow Agile Manifesto. So when we put there this kind of a, if we don't change anything there in between, we put there a framework that allows us to call us Agile without changing many things, basically, it doesn't change anything. You still have the teams there. They are separated from the business and separated from the customers. They have huge amount of coordination roles and hierarchy there in between. The LeSS solution in this problem would be that let's put these things to work together. And of course, it seems to be too simplistic. And basically, as we discussed on organizational design, you need to change how the teams are organized. It doesn't really work otherwise. And of course, you add there some business person to drive the teams, and how to scale up the business person, there's some solutions for that. And of course, without forgetting that the team should also discuss with their managers, and manager's job is there to ensure that we have capabilities in organization and we hire good people still when people leave, and they are basically stay in our organization as long as possible. Now, something about the summary of these things. SAFe, the slogan is program execution, one of the SAFe values. Then LeSS was coined by one person, like having to be customer-centric learning is the slogan could be there. Value proposition in safe, scale agile in safe, it is improved program execution, improved coordination, and maybe lean and agile ways of working also there. With less, basically, minimal bureaucracy could be one. Solution, program processes, agile in best practices, and then solution in less is basically you need to change your organization to focus on customer. Control mechanism, bureaucratic, and in the less, the control mechanism is basically you trying to use the mechanism from Scrum, basically market control and inside client control. And then adoption and scope there in the safe, it's basically one program at a time or one layer at a time. And in the less, it's one product at a time. And if your product is bigger than 100%, it's just one part of the product. Great. Did it take 5 minutes? All right, then we have more than 10 minutes for questions. No questions. Do they need a mic for the question? Yes, basically, when you have a really specialized teams, and you want the teams to be fully utilized, 100% utilized, and you have some customer request coming inside the organization, you can be pretty sure that the work is not evenly distributed. Some teams are really busy, some teams have lots of capacity. So let's add some new feature there. It distributes totally differently, but it needs some work for the one team that is really busy. So to make the work happen that we need from one team that's really busy, we extend the planning scope so they can actually do it. Specialization factor, it's basically, it should, we haven't really thought how to measure it. Probably you could measure it on how widely they work on the code base or how wide skills the teams have together. How to accommodate production issues. I'm not gonna go in that detail on any of the frameworks. Yes. The cost is more just because you plan longer. Yeah. So basically, no. There's a sprint planning. And the release planning is, of course, there's a release planning, but it's adjusted after each sprint. Yes. So it fits for your purpose. If you don't want to change anything, you get the framework where you basically can nicely put it on an organization with minimal changes, or you take another framework that you basically sets in the beginning that to achieve some significant change, you actually have to change something. Some persons have called, I was in one, this kind of a seminar or conference in Finland, called this kind of a safe as a Trojan horse of Agile, basically rollout. But if you discuss with manager that we are gonna bring Trojan horse in our organization, that will destroy our organization, how would the manager look at you? They fit in their organizational layers nicely. Quite nicely. Yes? So somebody mentioned that safe and less are, yeah, they have history and Nokia both. some of the history. And your question is about what? Yes. And SAFe was mainly used at Nokia mobile phones. And the LeSS is still used at Nokia networks. And where's Nokia mobile phones now? Maybe it didn't have anything to do with the Agile framework that they use there, but yeah. Sorry? SAFe is unsafe, yeah. No, I would say that it's really safe for the people in organization. Nothing will change. Or something will change there, but not so much. Very well adaptable. It just says that how you form your teams, that the advice is that you can have teams across the globe, but try to have the teams in one location. One team here and one team in the US. Instead of having this kind of a half team here and half team in the US, and they can't discuss with each other ever because of time zone differences. And that's not even coming from LeSS. I think it's just coming that forming teams like this is pretty much impossible. There was, yeah. scared the customers away. Maybe, maybe not. It's up to the basically discussion with customers that how often do you want to come and see us? How often you want to give us feedback? Making sure that we are developing the right product. If you have some customers. It could be that you develop product without any customers. You just try to develop product for the market that doesn't exist at all. There was something here, and then, sorry? Usage wise, popular. I have no idea. Sorry? Yes. I have this kind of a thinking that have you ever seen any organization when it does something so it becomes more simpler? Basically, I've never seen it. They always become more and more complex. If you start with quite many roles there and hierarchies, you probably can bet that they invent more. So it's highly unlikely that it will become simpler. I have no answer for your question. I don't know the future of the SAFe, what you're able to do with it. How does it compare with Nexus? I have not really studied Nexus so much. What I've read about it little bit seems that Nexus is just how you have teams and form a little bit with the teams without thinking much about the management on the organization or the adoption of the things in organization. But okay, somebody says that it's my view seems to be correct. So, yeah. Any other questions? Thank you.